welcome to Bedford TV News for Monday, April 11th, 2016. Reminder for those watching live, the news does repeat on Wednesday and Friday nights at 6 p.m. and is also available 24/7 at youtube.com/BedfordTVMA. And thanks, as always, to the Bedford Citizen for providing us with the outstanding news stories that you are about to hear. Like the first one about bikes, Dawn.
Yes, I am Dawn Kachubas. Oh, our lights aren't on. That's fun. The Nemirovsky family sent along a message to thank the Bedford community for their help with their bike drive. Quote, thank you, Bedford community. Have a look at this sea of bikes collected that day, despite the rain, for the people of Botswana. That is a sea of bikes. Thank you, B4H Boston, for inspiring us. The surprising part about today was how many people thanked us for collecting the bikes. Not because they would finally have room in their garage, but because many had been to Africa and knew the impact that bikes will have. We're feeling grateful for all the support shown today. End quote. Any wildlife sightings in Bedford, Dan Broswell?
Before the wildlife, I think we should come up with a clever name for a group of bikes. Oh. Like pods of whales and gaggles of geese. A bevy of bikes.
All right, I'll think about it while you talk about
that. I'm sure that you will. Foxes are the hot news item this week in Bedford. In recent weeks, there have been numerous fox sightings, not just one, numerous fox sightings around the Davis Road area, although I did see one near JGMS on Election Day, which also kind of stopped traffic on a Saturday morning, leading to speculation about what the fantastic Mr. Fox is up to. It was unanimous, however, that his confident nature was making residents more than a little bit nervous. Mr. Fox and his partner have taken up residence in the Battle Flag, with two G's, neighborhood based on numerous reports of sightings. The sightings have been reported to Animal Control Officer Mike Lasowski, as well as on the Davis Road Neighbors Facebook group. Mr. Fox has been spotted with various unidentified kill in his mouth. But according to Lasowski, the fox is likely noshing. Bedford Citizen writer. On the ample number of squirrels, ground birds, bunnies, and other rodents that populate the Davis Road Conservation Area. His level of activity indicates that he's feeding a pregnant or nursing female in the area, and his popularity has increased based on his hunting patterns being visible right on Davis Road. Look at that. Lasowski advises that people who come upon the fox be cautious and stay away. He suggests that if you are walking your dog carrying a small sports foghorn or a cowbell, more cowbell, will startle the fox, so he associates people with staying away, since foxes don't like loud noises. Also, don't leave garbage with leftover food out to entice him. Lasowski estimates the fox weighs an average of 7 to 15 pounds and is 35 to 41 inches long, but he could look bigger because of his full coat. He also advises that if you want your house to be fox, fisher cat, and coyote free, you should soak old shredded t-shirts in ammonia and put them in areas where the fox may hide, such as under a deck or a shed. This fox is not sick, and he's not aggressive, says Lasowski. If a fox or any animal was ill, he would be acting strange, like lying down, walking in circles, or being aggressive. Such an animal would stop being active after about 4 days and would be dead within 10. The fact that people keep seeing the same fox simply indicates that this is a healthy animal living in a suburban community with active wildlife. Lasowski encourages people who are still concerned to reach out to the Animal Rescue League for further education and information. That's pretty cool.
That fox is awfully cute.
Pretty cute fox. We should give it a name.
We should give it a name.
I'll think about that as you talk about history today.
I decide it should be called a blizzard of bikes. No. No good. Okay, I'll keep thinking.
Upon further review.
Maybe you could do a Twitter poll.
That's a really, really good idea.
Great.
Okay.
History Day. Massachusetts History Day, the statewide finals of the National History Day competition, will come to Bedford High School. Oh, I guess they already came. Saturday, April 9th. Middle and high school students from around the Commonwealth submitted courageously to the critical eyes of judges their history research projects. Students have worked individually or in teams of up to 5 students to research any historical topic of their choosing, but focused on a common theme: exploration, encounter, exchange in history. Students could present their research and argument in one of five media categories: documentary, exhibit, paper, performance, or website. Eight projects from Bedford High School qualified for the state competition and were up against the best in the Commonwealth. Number one, Sam Racky, Jared Rushanen, and Deborah Weidman. David Sarnoff and RCA, The Exploration of Broadcasting in Our Encounter of American Mass Culture, a group documentary. Sounds like something that should air on Bedford TV. Number two, Ava Altman, Maya Bostwick, and Emily Weigert. Rachel Carson, Exploring Pesticides and Encountering the Power of the Chemical Industries, a group documentary. Number three, Savannah N., Julia Gavalek, and Obieli Nwodo. Elizabeth Cady Stanton's Exploration of Women's Rights, Exchanges with Other Suffragists and Encounters with an Oppressive Society, a group website. Number four, Michelle Gong and Stella Miller, Reinventing Our Understanding of Humanity, Jane Goodall's Exploration of Chimpanzees and Encounters with the Scientific World, a group website. I lost count. Number five, Parker Taggart, Langston Hughes, An Exploration in the Self-Expression of African Americans, an independent performance. Number six, Connor Weisentainer, Chernobyl, The World's First Encounter with an Uncontrolled Radiation Spill, an independent website. I totally lost count now. John Coyne, George H.W. Bush, The Personal Encounters of the Diplomat President, an independent website. And finally, Liz Carter, Jackie Helms, and Ali Jew, Oppenheimer, Encounters with Communism, a group exhibit. Bedford High School history teachers who have guided the students in their projects include James Sunderland, Dave Boschetto, and Pat Culhane. The judging portion of the competition took place in the morning with the documentary, I hope that's supposed to say documentaries. Like, what's an documentary? And performances open to the public. Exhibits, papers, and websites were judged privately, but were open for public viewing in the early afternoon. Do we know who won? Nope.
Documentary.
I hope it was one of the documentaries.
I hope so too, because I've never seen an documentary before, and I hope.
I bet it's awesome.
Maybe we'll see it publicized. But by the way, the Twitter poll is open.
So fast.
Twitter followers, if you want to help name a alliterative group of bikes. Anyway, let's talk about the Town Compost Center, because that is also open. The Bedford Compost Center at 108 Carlisle Road will open for the season, or opened for the season, on Saturday, the 9th of April. The Compost Center will be open on selected Wednesdays from 8 a.m. to 2 p.m. and on selected Saturdays from 8 a.m. to 1 p.m. The Department of Public Works recently mailed each Bedford household the 2016 schedule for the Compost Center, which probably included those times. Yard waste is prohibited from regular trash. Residents may either compost yard waste on their own property or may bring the yard waste to the compost center on 108 Carlisle Road, where it will be turned into loam products for public works projects. Acceptable yard waste consists of leaves, pine needles, grass clippings, garden trimmings, weeds, and tree material up to 1 inch in diameter. Tree limbs more than 1 inch in diameter can be placed in the brush pile. Only craft paper style biodegradable bags available at a variety of stores are allowed to be dropped off. Residents should empty plastic trash bags or containers of yard waste and bring them home for reuse. Yard waste is one of the materials banned from the trash by the state, said Ed McGrath, Bedford's recycling coordinator. The options for disposing of leaves, grass clippings, and other yard waste are to either bring it to the town's compost center or start a compost pile in your yard. Compost bins are available for sale on sale for $45 from the Department of Public Works at 314 Great Road, 8 a.m. to 4 p.m., Monday through Friday. McGrath added that there will be a curbside collection of yard waste, but not until the fall. Have you ever been to the compost center, Dawn?
Many a time.
Really?
I measure each one of my branches individually.
That's good.
I bring a pair of calipers.
That's really exciting. I have never been to the compost center.
You still have not yet been?
I have run by it, but I've never.
Do you have your own compost center in your yard?
We have a nice, actually, I would say, area that we compost in, we do. Plus, we abut some nice conservation land, so maybe occasionally grass clippings end up in that.
Wow, you totally didn't say that. Did you know there's a new preschool director at St. Paul's?
I actually know her personally. It's very exciting.
Oh, my gosh. St. Paul's Week-A-Day
Weekaday.
I thought it was called Weekaday.
Weekaday.
I guess it's just Weekaday. That's more fun to call it Weekaday. Nursery school has some exciting news. After a several-month search process, they are delighted to announce that Sharon Healy will become their new director upon the retirement of their current director, Lee Frank, later this year. Mrs. Frank, as she has been known to the over 1,000 children she has helped nurture in her 22 years as a teacher and director at the school, has been a model of warmth and compassion. Board chairperson and school parent Sarah Scoville noted, I know, right? It's exciting to hear her name. We are so pleased to have found similar qualities and values in our new director, Sharon Healy, to carry on that legacy. Sharon Healy has been a preschool teacher for 13 years. She first discovered her vocation to this career when her children were enrolled at St. Paul's Weekday Nursery School nearly 20 years ago. Participating in the life of St. Paul's as a parent, she saw the joy that early childhood teachers and young children shared and wanted to experience something similar in her own work. Having worked previously as a high school teacher, she received additional training to become a preschool teacher and eventually a director, and began work in the field when her younger child entered first grade. During the interview process, those who spent time with Healy noted how well she understands and shares the values of community life, child-focused development, and learning through play that are hallmarks of St. Paul's Weekday Nursery School. They were also impressed with her ideas about further enhancing the mission of child-centered early education the school has pursued for over 55 years since their founding. Quote, Sharon's insight into the social and emotional development of children, combined with a collaborative spirit to work with teachers and parents, make us so excited for the future of the school, Scoville said. It's exciting. Congratulations.
Congratulations, Sharon. Very friend to many a Bedford resident. To many a Bedford resident, for sure.
She's on my new make a friend list. Don't you have one of those?
Yeah, sure.
Great.
Or I just take the friends that Facebook gives me for free on the recommended friend suggestion list.
Oh, well, that's one way to do it.
Or not. Let's talk about sports instead, because, you know, not much going on in the sports world. And while it was an eventful week in the weather department and the local sports universe, the weather adversely affected just about every Bedford team possible, with some exceptions. On Friday afternoon, girls lacrosse pulled off a sweep of the varsity and JV games against Cambridge, Ringe, and Latin, with a senior squad winning 10-9 and the JV squad winning 13-5. And boys varsity continued that trend with an emphatic 14-5 win over the Falcons. Boys tennis kicked off their 2016 season as reigning and defending state champions last Wednesday, but stumbled out of the gate, losing 4-1 to Acton Boxborough, and the girls lost 5-0 to the Colonials as well. This afternoon, girls softball and girls tennis both played host to Westford Academy, but no results have been posted as of showtime. And after much anticipation, boys baseball takes the field this Friday against the Rams from Shawsheen Tech, looking to repeat as DCL small tri-champions, or maybe even the sole champions this time around. Bays soccer kicked off on Saturday on a cold and windy afternoon, and this spring Bedford is fielding 22 teams, 11 girls teams and 11 boys teams, ranging from U9 to U14. Some interesting new rule changes this season, soccer fans, though, as heading the ball is now prohibited for U12 and under. That's correct. No intentional headers allowed, and it's a referee's discretion to see if it's an intended or unintended header. Bedford baseball and softball rosters have been set for what I believe are now 26 teams in the program between grades K and 9. Roster announcements were made over the weekend, and Sunday afternoon at 5 o'clock saw the JGMS auditorium packed with coaches and managers for the annual preseason meeting. Good times were had by some. The season kicks off on Monday, April 25th, and the official opening Saturday will be taking place all over town on Saturday, April 30th, with games throughout the day. In the American League, the four teams will again compete against Concord Carlisle teams on three different game nights this season, and also save the date for Player Appreciation Day and the annual All-Star Games on Saturday, May 21st. The Bruins, well, as I called it, collapsed and missed the playoffs. Celtics could finish anywhere from the 3 spot to the 6 spot in the Eastern Conference and currently sit at number 4, which if they hold onto would give them home court advantage in round one. The Revs drew again 1-1 against Toronto FC at home on Saturday, leaving them at a very uneventful 1-4-1 after six games, good for 7 points and fourth place in the East. The Red Sox played much better than expected out of the gate, splitting a pair of games in Cleveland and winning 2 out of 3 in Toronto, and faced the Orioles today in their home opener, and I'm sorry to say, I do not know what happened in that game, Don. Do you know what happened? I turned it off when they were losing 5-3.
Red Sox lost,
so way to go, guys, to not hold the lead. with the biggest news of the week, Villanova stunned UNC to win the men's NCAA tournament on a buzzer-beating three-pointer, and UConn easily beat Syracuse for yet another women's title. And the Warriors not only beat the Spurs twice, but also came back from a 10-point fourth-quarter deficit on Friday, and are now at 72-9 with one game left to go on Wednesday versus Memphis. And with a win, they will finish at 73-9, the best record in NBA history. And lastly, in one of the more absurd moments in recent Red Sox history, Pablo Sandoval, he of the not-too-rigorous off-season training program, Don, if you remember, has been benched for the most part in early-season play, but did get an at-bat over the weekend, which featured him swinging and missing mightily and literally bursting his belt buckle from a tricky combination of torque, belly chub, and embarrassment. Nice job, Panda. Thanks for the laughs. This is Dan Broskell. Not sure when I'll see you next with Baseball on Mondays coming up, but have a great April vacation, and I'll talk to you soon.
I'm going to be the last newscaster standing next week. That'll be fun.
You can do it.
It's me who wants more Dawn time. Oh, boy. Sad Jen's not here because she loves talking about the opera lectures.
Who doesn't?
I'll have to do the best I can, Jen. Coming up this week on Monday, an opera lecture series sponsored by the Bedford Center for the Arts will resume on tonight, April 11th at 7 p.m. at First Parish Bedford with Donizetti's Roberto Devereux. David Collins, well known in opera circles in the greater Boston area, will continue the BCA's fourth year of providing opera lovers warm-ups for upcoming performances of the Metropolitan Opera that are simulcast in local theaters. Roberto Devereux will be shown in theaters on April 16th. Devereux is the third opera by Donizetti dealing with Tudor queens. These operas are great challenges for even the best sopranos in grand opera, so there is always great excitement when these operas are performed. Anna Bolena and Maria Stuarda are generally more frequently performed, so a chance to see a performance of Roberto Devereux is a rare opportunity. David Collins will explore the plot and historical background of the opera with music and videos, including singers of the past who are famous for their portrayal of the role of Elizabeth. Bob Bass, coordinator of the opera lecture series, commented that, quote, "We are especially excited about this lecture because it will prepare us to see the live and HD telecast of perhaps the most exceptional performance of the year at the Met, and one that will stand beside other famous events over the history of the Metropolitan Opera." Lectures are held in the Bacon Room, overlooking the town green in First Parish. Space is limited and pre-registration is required. Individuals wishing to attend can send a check made payable to the... Don't send your check now. It will not get there in time. I guess you can bring a check.
Yes.
Payable to the BCA and hope there's room. The cost is $15 per individual for BCA members or $20 for others. Maybe you can squeeze in some online registration. It's available at bedfordarts.wildapricot.org. Do you call it an apricot or an apricot?
Now, what do you think I say?
Apricot.
I absolutely say apricot.
It's not right, but okay.
Well, you know, we always agree on pronunciations. I'm stunned.
Every
I'm stunned
day.
We don't see eye to eye on this one. I'm a firm believer in apricot. But how about tomorrow? Let's talk about self-defense. Self-defense. The Bedford Police, in collaboration with the Domestic Violence Services Network Incorporated, DVSN, is offering a RESIST, that's all caps, self-defense class for young women. The goal of the course is to learn how to escape from an attacker by using instinct-based moves. On day one, we will talk about general safety and dating safety before learning and then practicing physical self-defense moves like strikes, blocks, and knee strikes. On day two, students and instructors will don protective gear, not Dawn, Dawn, protective gear, and participants will be attacked using learned moves to escape. This part of the course is intense, but amazing and empowering. The course will be held on April 12th, Tuesday, and April 14th, Thursday, from 3:30 to 6:30 p.m., and is open to all high school and college-aged girls who are residents of Bedford. The course is free, but pre-registration is required. For questions and to register, please contact Jenna Salon at jennasalon, J-E-N-A-S-A-L-O-N, at gmail.com. But it doesn't say where it's going to be. You know where it's going to be?
No.
Wait. I think it's, I'm guessing high school or police station.
Well, I'm sure Jenna Salon knows.
I'm sure Jenna. So ask Jenna all of your questions.
You know, in part of that opera piece, it says Roberta at one point. There's no Roberta. It's just Roberto. Sorry. No, I just wanted to say that in case anyone thought I did that. I didn't do it.
It's great.
I guess that was unnecessary.
It's okay.
My apologies.
Talk about the Garden Club.
Okay, the Garden Club. The monthly meeting of the Bedford Garden Club will be held at 9:30 a.m. on Tuesday, April 12th at the Bedford Public Library in Bedford. The club is excited to have Deborah Trickett present a program called Crazy for Coleus.
What's Coleus?
I don't know. Deborah is an award-winning container garden designer, and she has worked in the gardening industry for over 30 years, starting with her first job in a greenhouse at age 13 until the present as the owner of The Captured Garden. That's a very dramatic name. I like that. Deborah works with clients throughout New England who want their homes to be beautiful, not typical. By combining unusual plant material and creative design ideas, she creates gardens and containers that are truly one of a kind. For information on the Bedford Garden Club, visit bedfordgardenclub.org, or you can call them at 781-275-8794. Dan pulled up a picture of Coleus. What is it?
It's very beautiful. It's got a green leaf with like a watermelon center. I know.
Oh, that seems lovely. Wow.
That's a great zoom in. Yeah. It's gorgeous. Coleus. I've learned something new today.
I learned a lot of
all right.
Today.
But Thursday, the event of the week in Bedford, absolutely, is the Bedford TV Open House right here in studio. Be sure to join us at the BTV Open House Thursday, April 14th from 5:30 to 7:30 p.m. Learn more about Bedford TV, eat snacks, and listen to a special presentation on the history and theory of film editing by none other than the wonderful, talented, amazing, incredible writer of this script, Greg Dolan. Nice job, buddy. He's the best. If you've ever been curious about what goes on at a TV station, if you have a good idea for a TV show, if you make videos at home, if you'd like to play with our state-of-the-art high-def recording equipment, or if you're interested in volunteering or interning with us, then this open house is the place to be. And Dawn, are you coming to the open house?
Oh, sure.
I will be here. Maybe, in fact, all the kids. So it's going to be a big family affair.
All five.
Yeah, we're all going to wear green and vanish into the green screen.
Wow. All right, wow.
Perhaps.
I'll look forward to that fun time. How about Friday, if you survive the BTV open house? Mozart, two pianos, four hands. Part of the First Parish in Bedford's year-long celebration of the 225th anniversary of Mozart's death, a concert featuring two grand pianos played by acclaimed pianists Leslie Amper and Randall Hodgkinson will take place in the sanctuary of the historic meeting house on April 15th at 7 p.m. with a pre-concert talk and refreshments. I love refreshments. At 6:30, Amper and Hodgkinson, a husband and wife team, will perform solo and two piano sonatas by Mozart, some with accompaniments by Edvard Grieg, including the famed sonata in D major for two pianos, four hands, K448. A pre-concert talk will be given by historian and pianist Bradford Connor, and refreshments will be available for talk attendees.
And we know that you love the refreshments.
Oh, did somebody mention that earlier? Yes, I do. Oh, how about some barbecue and blues? More refreshments. There will be a barbecue and blues concert with Bill McQuaid this Saturday at First Parish Church. I feel like we're just reading the First Parish Church bulletin. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
pick it up what I'm putting down. The concert starts at 8 p.m. and there will be a homemade barbecue supper before at 7 p.m. Admission is $25 for the concert only and $40 for the supper as well.
Supper?
I don't use the word supper enough.
Who says supper?
Says supper. Maybe Greg Dolan uses the word supper.
Isn't supper like usually before dinner?
What? How many dinners do you eat?
Like clat?
I don't think so. I think they're synonyms.
Okay. I think they're not synonyms.
Where's our Bedford TV thesaurus?
No votes yet in the poll, so please, I want at least one vote.
No, that's not true. I voted. And I didn't even vote for my own. All proceeds will benefit the Star Island All-Star 2 Financial Aid Fund. And now, let's hear what the weather's going to be with Maria.
Yay! Thank you. A change in weather pattern will allow northeastern United States to finally escape shots of Arctic air and snow this week. After a mild start to the new week, a passage of cold front and its rain will allow the cooler air to work back into Bedford Tuesday into Wednesday. However, the core of Arctic air in the wake of the front will just give our area a glancing blow. Temperatures will take a tumble back into slightly below normal readings Tuesday into Wednesday, but fall well short of chilly readings for the weekend. How the rest of the week for the Bedford area unfolds will depend on the evolution of the storm that is expected to form along the tail end of the front. The storm should remain offshore or settle along the southeastern coast. In this scenario, the northeast would join the Great Lakes in experiencing a lengthy stretch of dry or milder air. Residents would have plenty of opportunities to get outdoor and most of the activities that were put on hold amid the chilly and unsettled start to April. However, such outdoor plans will be spoiled if the storm takes shape closer to the northeast. Even if this scenario unfolds, residents will not have to worry about the storm leading into a repeat of this winter-like weekend. The area will not be cold enough for snow to return and extended the wild winter and set numerous records in the northeast. If the storm fails to push rain into the northeast, it could still allow a flow of air to stream from the chilly Atlantic Ocean. This scenario would cause places in the east of the Appalachian Mountains to see temperatures climb back above normal, slower than points to the west. If the dry and mild spell unfolds, many residents should still resist the urge to get an early jump on planting sensitive vegetables or plants later in the week and this weekend. As is typical of spring, cooler air will attempt to fight back at the warmth. There are already signs of that happening in the northeast during the second half of the week. Temperatures will once again be held at or below normal for a day or two, but we are not going back into a deep freeze. It gets hard to recharge cold airs this late in the season. That's this week in weather.
Thanks, Maria. Dan has some breaking news about tennis.
Boys tennis lost today 4-1 to the Grey Ghosts in Westford. So defending state champions now 0-2 on our very young season.
Sad.
Almost as sad as sensitive vegetables falling victim to a late frost.
Yeah, also sad.
Moment of silence for those sensitive vegetables.
Thanks, Dan. Well, this was a great episode of Bedford TV
pretty,
News.
It's pretty good. But not as good as the BTV open house is going to be, so we'll see you on Thursday at 5:30 right here in the studio.
Do you think people will be able to try out the new teleprompter?
Well, wouldn't that be exciting?
So fun. Maybe I could try out the new teleprompter.
It would be a first, Dawn.
It would be a first. I didn't even try to sit in Gen Z.
I dare say you could even send a script that you want to read on air, maybe, as long as it's appropriate, and you could practice reading off the teleprompter.
As long as it's appropriate.
As long as it's appropriate.
What you were suspecting.
Well, I mean, by the way, the results of the poll are in.
Did I win?
100% of the vote. A group of bikes is called a boatload of bikes. So we've now coined a new term for the online university.
How do you think the bikes are getting there? Where are they going, Botswana?
I think they're going on a boat.
The boatload of bikes are headed to Botswana. You can write a storybook about this. Oh, everybody should go out and get their own copy of Modern Girls, written by Jennifer S. Brown, because she's going to be a future guest on Bedford TV. It's a great read. Pick it up, and then you'll be ready for our book talk. It's going to be fun.
Friend of Bedford TV, Jennifer Brown, talented author, and we talked about her before.
We have.
In the context of traffic, but now she's a published author. So nice job, Jenny, and we'll see you on the air hopefully this spring.
All right, well, for Bedford TV News, I'm Dawn Kachubas.
And I'm Dan Broskell.
Thanks for joining us. Have a great week.